today. What a, you know, again, no humidity. That makes a difference and then some. But I just want to welcome everybody. If you're here for the first time, I'd love to have you fill out a card. If you've been here forever, if you have a prayer request or a question, that's one of the best ways is with the card. Fill that out and put it into the offering plate or hand it to one of the deacons throughout the service or after the service, and we will take care of things. But it's just nice to be up and about. What a beautiful day. Yesterday, after that storm on Friday, that was a mess for us at our home. We got way too much rain, but it is what it is. I just want to welcome Danielle home to us. You know, welcome back. You too, Doug. And it's really nice seeing the parking lot getting redone and kind of finished. There's a couple little extra things they have to do, but they'll be back on there. And also, I'd like to, I think Dan's running the board today. Are you up there today, Dan? Oh, I see you now. I see you. Well, today is Dan's anniversary, and Dan and Gracie's anniversary. So, you know, when you see him, wish him happy anniversary. It's been 34 years, I think he said. Isn't that pretty good? But usually I don't go through all this, but I think Steve and Lori's celebrating an anniversary coming up. How many years for you, Lori?
32.
And Doug and Danielle. Oh, Patty? 34, Doug? 39 years. And then I'm going to save for the old ones for the end because they may be over 60-ish. Ron, how many years?
What's that, sir?
How many years have you been married to that beautiful lady next to you?
The Christian lady next to me is 70.
70 years. That's pretty good. And nobody here argues that, Ron. Nobody's going to argue that.
I did not think they would. And I wish to thank people that gave us a special card.
Yes.
Anniversary. Thank you.
And again, it's wonderful just sharing our lives together in a different way. But, you know, it's not often that we go from, you know, having so many in the 30s, and then I knew one would double that and be up there. So congratulations to everybody that celebrates life together. And then finally, before we go in, the trustees, again, there's more work to be done that we talked about during a meeting, but one of those things that we talked about was the need for a choir director. And so please continue to pray that we need a choir director because, we have found somebody. Like she surprised us on the piano. Heidi Corliss has agreed to step back in and do it right. So come on up. I'm excited. I can't just do it easy.
He told other people before he told me. He just told me just now.
Wait, who did I say? I haven't told anybody.
You told Tamara.
Oh, I did tell Tamara.
Uh-huh.
I told her not to say anything, though.
And I got paperwork as I came in the church.
You did?
Yeah. I have agreed to come back. I have missed it terribly. 2 years ago when I decided to resign as music director, it was because I needed some flexibility. So my proposal this week to Carl came with flexibility. There will be Sundays I won't be here because my children live all far away. So I hope you will accept that, and because I'm anxious to get back started. Being part of a choir is a really exciting fellowship. And the choir members and I have a great time together while we work hard. I would welcome those people who think they have any singing ability to join us. And you really don't have to be a soloist. All of them will tell you that when we get together, we learn together. So if you have any interest at all, talk to me. Also, I will be most of the time choosing hymns. So if you have favorites that you would like to see or hear or sing, let me know. If there are things that you don't like, please feel free to come to me as well. Don't go to Carl, come to me. All right, so.
I appreciate that.
So we will be getting started. I think our first rehearsal is gonna be August 28th, and our first Sunday singing will be the 2 weeks after Labor Day. So happy to be back.
And so while Heidi mentioned about the anthems or the hymnal selections, I will already cover her right now because there'll be times when I will switch those. So if it happened to be one that you picked and I don't know about it, forgive me in advance. It won't be intentional, but if the idea of the direction that we're going changes, then we like the music to go with it as well. God is good. And so as we gather here in your hymnal, I'll do this real quick, in your hymnal after the doxology, after offertory, Les will be, again, blessing us with his talent of music and a couple songs that you all know and invited to sing along. But in the meantime, let us just take a breath and just let the Spirit move us, push us, and guide us as the light of Christ is brought into today's sanctuary. With by a beautiful lady. We welcome you back home, Tamara. You know, as she was gone daily, I prayed for her and And then as I knew when she was coming back, she gave me a long notice this time about when she was coming back. So we prayed for a safe return and everything went well. And it's just good to have you back home, Tamara. Blessings. Let us, God's people, be in the spirit of prayer and let us pray together. Gracious and holy God, Father, you know our hearts. You know our concerns and our joys at this very moment. Almighty and holy God, we give you thanks. We know that you hear our prayers, that you are with us at all times. Father, we pray to you and before you of our own hopes, our own visions, and our own needs. Lord, we give you thanks for the facility that we have to worship you here at East Orrington. We thank you for those that volunteer and makes this service happen week in and week out. We thank you for each of the board members who volunteer their time. And Lord, I am excited by a start of another fall season of bringing in different ideas. Almighty and holy God, as we journey through this thing called life, may we live a life of gratitude. May we be content with everything we have. Even in the bad times, O Lord, we know that we have you. We have an eternal home waiting for us. Mighty and holy God, we pray for this country. We pray for our president and all elected officials. We pray for the nations around us and around the world and for their leaders, even those that we may call our enemies. We pray that all of us can have our hearts open to be able to listen and find something common to work with. Almighty God, may your peace sustain us. May your peace overtake us. Almighty and holy God, we give you thanks for those that serve in the military here in this country. We pray for their safekeeping and their hearts are to be opened to hear and to be part of the peace. We pray for the families that are oftentimes left behind. But we pray this for all that must travel for their jobs, from over-the-road truckers to many other fields. Lord God, we pray for the first responders, our fire department, police department, healthcare workers. We pray for those that are working within the hospitals and so many other fields that are called at the last minute. Be with us all, Lord, as we pray that maybe just a little bit of who you are is in each of us, and we listen to that voice of compassion and hope. Lord God, we take this time, a few minutes, to just lift up our own personal joys and concerns at this time as we sit in the silence of your word. Mighty and holy God, hear our prayers. Hear our prayers for each other that are here today. We pray for those that are joining us either online or later on through media. We pray for those that are at home and because of health reasons or whatever the reason is. We pray for those that we don't see as often today. Pray that their safekeeping is with you. Almighty and holy God, we pray. We pray as you have told us to pray. We pray for all to know who you are. Father, we pray for our local communities and our neighbors. We pray that your grace continues to rain down upon us. May we know and live in the understanding that we are blessed people through you. Lord God, be with us. as we give you thanks for getting Tamara back home to us safe and sound, for the safe travels of Doug and Danielle and all others who have been traveling this summer. We pray and give you thanks for the blessings we have in this church and the community in which we live. Lord, may your blessings continue upon us. May we continue to live a life of gratitude. And as you'll say in Scripture, may we stop grumbling and just see the beauty that surrounds us. Lord God, we give you thanks. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. And Lord, we turn to him, remembering the words he taught us to pray that says,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. If you'd join me. And if you remain standing and join me in our first hymn, found on page 520, O Beautiful for Spacious Skies.
Thank you.
Please remain standing. Don't sit as we normally would, because part of the offertory today is understanding the blessings we have within this church, of the blessings that God has blessed us with each other. And so I'm going to, for the call to offertory today, I'm simply going to ask you to turn to your neighbor and friends right near you and give them the right hand of fellowship or the fist bump or the elbow bump, whatever you want, but the right hand of love from God. Where's mine? Where's mine? Oh, there you go. So as we make our way back to our seats, I ask the ushers for today's service to please come forward for today's offertory. Thank you. Gracious and holy God, Father, we thank you for everything. We thank you for the gifts you have blessed us with, the gift of laughter and fun to be able to relax here in this church, but with you, O Lord, in whatever we're doing. Almighty God, may you continue to bless this church family, and we ask for your blessings upon these very gifts. May they be multiplied to do your work, and may it be seen in the way we conduct ourselves and the way we help others. Almighty God, we give you thanks and praise in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Like the pastor said, you should know the choruses of both of these songs, so sing loud.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. We shall sing on that beautiful shore. We shall notice songs of the blessed, and our spirit shall sorrow no more, not a sigh for the blessing of rest. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer our tributes of praise for the glorious gift of his love and the blessing that hallows our days. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. Find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. And in my hour of darkness, she is standing right in front of me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, Lord, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the broken-hearted people living in the world agree. There will be an answer, let it be. For though they may be parted, there is still a chance that they will see. There will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, Lord, let it be. There will be an answer, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And when the night is cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. Shine until tomorrow, let it be. I wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, Lord, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be, Lord, let it be. There will be an answer, let it be.
For many of us, that answer was delivered by Christ. He is the answer. He is the reason. Today, we're going to be looking at the Gospel of John again, chapter 6, verse 35, and then verses 41 through 51. But as I've been doing, and I'll continue to do, I urge you to take your bulletins home or look online at the bulletin that's online on our website. And read the other scriptures as well and just discern and connect how they go together, or maybe they don't. But hear the word of God in your quiet times during this week. So today again, we're going to be reading again from the book of John, chapter 6. But before we do, I ask you to join with me as we say the unison prayer together.
Lord, upon the pages of this book is your story. It is also
Amen. John 6. Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." At this, the Jews there began to grumble about him because he said, "I am the bread of life that came down from heaven." They said, "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, 'I came down from heaven'?" "Stop grumbling among yourselves," Jesus answered. "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws them, and I will raise them up on the last day. It is written of the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard the Father and learned from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. This is the word of God. Amen. At this time, I'm going to welcome some of our youth from downstairs to come on in. As they come in, I just want to welcome those that may be joining us on Facebook Live. Once again, whether you're here at this very moment or you catch us a little bit later on, it's wonderful to have you part of our family here at the church. And I will encourage you to, online, there's a donation button. You're more than welcome to donate, as well as we strive to make the ministry of this church, East Storrington, vibrant within our community. So many of you that might have been here last week or heard it last week, you may have heard that same passage, verse 35, where Jesus declares himself the bread of life. Last week, John challenges us, I believe, to consider what kind of bread we seek. I talked about the different varieties of bread and what ones are we consuming and eating. Is it perishable or imperishable? Jesus says, I am the bread of life. And when he says this, it begins a conflict, is what we hear in today's passage. We hear those that are around him, the Jews that are around him, saying, wait a second. Isn't this fella, this Jesus guy, simply the son of Joseph and Mary, I would say? We know him and his parents. But the question comes, but do they? See, I believe they knew of him. They might have even seen him walking around at times. But do they truly know him? I would guess by this passage, the answer is no. Even though they're declaring that we know who he is, by their remarks and their actions, I don't believe they do. What I read in this passage is they're stuck. The people that are hearing this and the Jewish people at the time, they were stuck in their ways. They knew what the past was, and they had that in their box, and that's all they lived on was the past. And nothing, all they could think of was when Jesus talks about the bread of life, was the manna. You know, they knew that the manna that the ancestors ate in the wilderness, and that's what they equated Jesus to in his saying. And Jesus knew this, and he calls them out. He says to them, and again, boy, wouldn't this be nice to say sometime, stop grumbling. Stop grumbling. Stop grumbling and talking about what you know nothing of. I'm going to go side here. Stop grumbling for what they know nothing of. What they knew nothing of is what Jesus had in mind for them. What God had in mind for them in the very beginning. What they knew nothing of was going to be different from what they knew. Different from the past. So they knew nothing of what Jesus was teaching them, because they could not see outside that box. They could not see by the past. So Jesus says to them, yes, your ancestors ate the manna and they died, but I am the bread of life. Jesus, I believe, is offering them, and I believe he is offering us today, a choice. Living bread or manna? Life or death? Divine grace or worldly judgment? The conflict they are having in them, as we hear in this passage, I do not believe is between a Jew and Jesus. It is a conflict that they're having from within them. And I believe it's a conflict we often have within us that we can't let go. You know, as the songs, let it be, let it go. Trust. See, I believe this passage is about them and Jesus offering them a way to step out of their box, but it's offering us to step out of our comfortable, familiar boxes and letting God lead us to where we need to be. And sometimes that's hard to do. I don't know about any of you, but sometimes it's hard to just let go. And I'm not talking just about letting go of critical life things. Yesterday, I took some items to the ReStore, but one of the stands was a stand that I was in our bathroom and we created, and it had all our kids' names on it. And it sat there, and it was like, well, I'll never use it again. But I didn't want to give it away. I was stuck in the past. But then I know somebody needs it, and we needed to let it go. Sometimes we're stuck in the past that we can't see the path forward that God is offering to you and us right now. I think that is part of this church journey right now, that vision that we have to look at. See, we, like the Jews, have our own frames of references, our own biases. And because we have those biases, a lot of times what we try to do is we try to frame and put God in the box that we can bring God into, instead of letting God take us to a new box, a greater box, a bigger box. And what happens is when we try to control God and bring him into ours, what I hear often by Christians and not Christians, but by Christians is I still have an empty life. I don't get it. I still feel empty. And a lot of times what it is because we're working for the manna. We're thinking that what I do, instead of receiving the bread of life. Now, don't get me wrong. I think we need to work. I think we need to provide. We need to fill our bellies with food to survive. But no matter how hard we work, and James will say this too, no matter how hard we work, we cannot fill our souls through work. It can only be brought through the bread of life. We can only find that deep comfort that doesn't matter what's going on around us, and that peace through the bread of life. I think that's important for us. Our patterns of thinking and believing our history and not letting go of that past often convince us to just remain the same. Stay the status quo. Don't change. But Jesus is saying, it does not have to be that way. I can show you a new way. And the table of God, as we did last week, that table of God is set out before us. We are invited to eat his bread. We are offered and given the opportunity to step out into a new way of living and a new way of being. See, folks, I believe that God heard his people crying. He heard the cries of the people, knowing that they were hungry and they are hungry, and today they are hungry. And so he sent his son. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. And whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. I am the bread of life. Jesus is inviting us to open our hearts. Not just one time and done, but right now, today, in this very spot that you're sitting in, or if you're listening online, he's inviting us to open our hearts and hear in a new way. Jesus is inviting us to open our hearts and bind our hearts with him into a relationship that will bring you to new heights, new understandings, to sustain you and give you life-giving hope and transform you. See, many times I hear people, oh, God has changed me. Well, you know what? That's great, but he's not done. Right, John? He's not done with us yet, right? We are a work in progress. But we become transformed. And that's where I really want to concentrate today, is on that understanding of transform. It's where I want to focus. Because I believe that we too are called to be the bread of life to this world. We are called to live our lives to feed others. Not to come into this church to say, what can I get? I need. But it's also to give, to be part of. We are called to feed others, to feed the souls of this world, the love, the forgiveness, the wisdom, as the song sang, of God's presence. As Jesus nourished others to new life in the scriptures, as we read, but I know he nourished my life to a new life and continues to do it. I believe through his love and his presence, through his forgiveness and his guidance, through his healing and his grace, through his compassion, and the list can go on and on, right? But we too need to nourish the world around us. For many don't know Christ, and many that do know Christ have lost their way in the thinking that it's about this, it's about the worldly things, and it's not, folks. It's about your heart being transformed to feed others in that love and that compassion and that forgiveness. In order to do this, our hearts need to be transformed and open to the daily bread. The daily bread. It's right here, folks. What you need to sustain you is contained within the Word of God. Scripture. We need to be meditating in that daily bread of prayer, meditating in His Word, meditating in, I believe, in God's works as well. What did Jesus show us? We need to meditate on what that means for us. When He refused to take revenge, when He healed the ear after Peter cut it off, knowing what this very person that maybe he cut the ear off would be leading him to, he healed that person. That's what we're called to do. We may not always agree, but we're called to continue to walk together as Jesus continued to walk with each other. We need to be dependent on Jesus Christ, not on man, for everything. Jesus must be the center. We need to depend on our Lord and Savior for our physical needs, our strength, our emotional well-being. And we need to depend on the daily bread for spiritual growth each and every day. We live by the bread when we trust Him in all the avenues of our life. That there's not a second that goes by that we're not talking to God and saying, Lord, guide me. Help me. There's not a message that I come out here that I don't pray before I come out to say, Lord, guide my tongue. Don't lead me astray too bad, but may my word be the bread of life. See, He will provide what we need each day if we trust. So as you consume His bread, His love, and His teachings, and you follow His examples, I believe your character will become to be shaped. You know, as it talks about molding the clay, that will start to happen, and your character will be shaped to reflect His love, His patience, His kindness, His forgiveness. It'll allow you to sit and be part of something, even if you don't fully agree or understand. This transformation impacts your relationship with yourself and God, with your spouse or your partner. It impacts your relationship with your work or your home, or however you engage in the world. It will impact that relationship as you continue to eat that bread. See, when things you thought were important, when you start consuming that bread, those will fade away. Now, see, Dan will sometimes mention a competitive person, and dang gummit, I am. But I'm not anything like I used to be. See, I used to, a sports team, if Patriots don't good, dang gummit, my day's ruined. See, as you consume that bread, the more and more you consume it, that just falls aside, and we're just blessed people. You know, it may be how so many people are hooked on television, or I don't have my phone, but our phones, As you consume more and more bread, you'll realize we don't need these things like we think we do. Set them down. Let the Lord feed you. Some people I know turn on the news 24/7. Turn it off and hear the news of God, that He is providing you new life and new bread, wholesome and true. See, as I've told many people, you will not see Jesus talk about the issues of the day. He's concerned about the heart of the soul of the day. That's you and me. See, when we take communion here in this church, as a community, I hope you are reminded of the sacrifice that Jesus laid out for you, what He went through. But I also hope you are reminded that when we eat His body, that His flesh, the bread, that we are proclaiming that His continued presence is in our life. That's what that is representing. And that He will come back and change and do what He has said. His promises are true. Communion is a time to open your heart and reaffirm your faith and your dependence on Him as the ultimate source of all life, both now and eternal. See, a life that radiates hope, the sure and certainty of the promises that God's word, God's promises, the promises of Jesus are true. That's what the bread will feed you and to reassure you that there is hope. A life that will show that peace is possible. Maybe not in the nation, but within me and that conflict that I sometimes have within myself, that we can have that internal peace. That the arrows that some may throw at you or me will be shielded by the grace of God. And you can know that peace no matter what's going on. An inner joy of a transformed heart. To know without a doubt that you are a beloved child of God. And a life, amen indeed, a life that overflows with love for all people. Not just those that we choose, but for all people. And I believe it gives us, as we consume that bread, a knowledge that we don't know it all. A knowledge that we don't know everyone. We don't know the shoes that they're wearing and their path they're taking. Just as Jesus was willing to share the bread of life with His disciples, and I believe through the word with each and every one of us, I believe we are called to share that bread of life with the community around us, but with each other, your neighbor and a friend. I believe that we are called to be generous, to be of hope, to be of that joy, the grace of truth that you've received, and we're supposed to pass that out to others in the best way we can. Being shown, I believe that when you're eating and consuming this bread of life, I believe that you'll see it in acts of service, fellowship, supporting each other in the faith community that we live in and other faith communities that we share our lives with. We would become an encouragement to build the kingdom of God, not the kingdom of the United States or the kingdom of England or the kingdom of France, but the kingdom of God, which is for all people. See, I believe in my heart of hearts that this church is on the right direction. I see it within the men's group, and I'm hearing it within women's fellowship. Something is happening, and I want to be a part of it. Something is happening that our old choir director becomes our new choir director. Transformation, hope, building. See, I think when Jesus says, "You will never go hungry," He is speaking to a deep spiritual satisfaction and being content that comes from knowing Him in a very personal and deep way. Oftentimes, I will have people sometimes say, I don't understand how you can be content. I don't understand how you can be at peace. And it says, my answer will always be, you need to know Christ. And then you'll understand. But you need to know him. You have to put time into getting to know him. Living in that bread means finding the ultimate fulfillment in Jesus rather than the temporal pleasures of this world or the material things. It's about putting our trust in God completely. See, I picked the first hymn for a reason. I'm tired of hearing how everybody else has made this world beautiful or perfect. It was God who created this world perfectly. It is God who made America beautiful. It is God who will lead us to the promised land. It is God who will give you freedom and peace and hope by eating the living bread that he is providing to us through Jesus Christ, his son. Now, I'm not saying that we don't have work to do together to build this nation up. I'm not saying that. But let us never make a mistake that it is God who created what we enjoy today. It is God. When we eat that bread, it's about resting in the assurance that Jesus Christ is enough for you. The Apostle Paul says it so beautifully in so many different ways. To just be content. Jesus is the bread of life. And he points us to the eternal life, giving us a perspective on eternity, not just the temporal moments right now. Recognizing that your home is with God. You know, I think the song you sang first, I don't know how you connected it, both songs, so well, but it's about knowing that we have a place waiting for us. What does that do for you today? How does that change you today? Loving others and seeing God and the kingdom as your future. Knowing your life is part of something much larger. It's part of the eternal story of God the Father. You are the bread of life. Have you ever heard that saying, which I'm sure many of you have, you are what you eat? Yeah. Well, you know, I believe that to be so true. As I read this scripture, by seeing Jesus as the bread of life, knowing we are open, need to open our hearts to be transformed, to be nourished by his presence and his gift of life, but allow his life to flow directly through you to nourish others. I believe that's what we need to do. But I also know that if we eat what the world wants to feed us, that's what we will give out to the world around us. Somebody said to me today that they just can't be around the negativity anymore. I can't do it anymore. And they said it wasn't too long ago that that was part of their life. But something is transforming them, and I believe it's the bread of life that is transforming not just them, but all of us, I hope, to say, that's no longer needed. I don't need the negativity. I don't need the tearing down. I need the building up of the kingdom. How many of you watched the Olympics? Many? I listened to much of it. But did you notice so many times the people were saying how honored they are to be representing their country? It's an honor to represent for me, the goosebumps of listening to the national anthem and watching them on the podium, it was always, every time I'd get goosebumps. I don't know about any of you, but over and over again, they were talking about such an honor to represent their country. And I believe their action, for many, showed whether they are truly honoring their country in how they responded to winning, but also how they responded to losing. And I believe that's the truth for each and every as we follow Jesus Christ. I believe it is an honor to be a child of God. I believe it is a privilege to be offered to follow Christ in my life, to represent God's kingdom here on earth. I believe that's what we're called to do. And my question to you is, do we live that? Are we honoring God in all we say and all we do? See, our actions matter. Consuming the bread of life will build that character of action. So are we offering the bread of life to other people? Or is it just empty words? Folks, God loves you. He loves me best, but he does love you. I have a sign that I think Therese gave me a long time ago, right? Jesus loves me, but he loves you more, something to that effect. But folks, this passage, we need to really hear it and listen to it. Are we consuming the bread that is perishable or imperishable? And I invite you to join me as we continue to journey in our vision of this church to consume the imperishable bread. And let's see what God can lead us to do. I don't think God's done with us yet. And I'm certainly not done with my Lord yet. I need him every day, for he has to be my daily bread. And I hope he is your daily bread. And somewhere along there, every day, you'll open this book and you'll see him. But more importantly, you'll also see yourself. You'll see the good, the bad, and the ugly. As you're fed the bread of life, your heart will be transformed. God is good. So let's open the book, this book, and honor him by reading and learning and growing. Amen?
Amen.
And so our last hymn is Peace in Our Time, O Lord. So I encourage you to stand and join me in this last hymn.
Please be seated. You know, that song we just sang, it has it all. It encompasses our whole walk with Christ, but there's that one line. Sound noblesse call. In love so great that men shall cast aside all other gods and turn to you again. What he is saying is, cast aside the bread that is perishable and let us eat the bread that is imperishable.
Let us learn to love as God has loved us. For in Christ, this is the promise, in Christ there is no end. May we live that way and show our love for all people. Amen. May each of us go in the love and the peace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Go in peace. Amen. I will remind the advisory board that there is a meeting in the boardroom 5 minutes from now. So go downstairs, get coffee, and I hope everybody else can join in fellowship.